shows does for the reputations of our sporting heroes what faith healing did for Glenn Hoddle. It's in the world of football that we begin as one of Europe's top coaches unveils a radical solution to the problems of a leaky defence. One of the game's leading strikers denies he's letting results go to his head. And there's championship success for the first team to be fed on a special diet of genetically modified food. But those aren't the people who really deserve your sympathy. Spare a thought, if you will, for the game's goalkeepers. Take a look at this. I suppose embarrassment is all part of the goalkeeper's life. Just think of Peter Schmeichel playing the ukulele in those bacon commercials. But help is at hand for the custodians of the onion bag as we go inside football for our dive to goalkeeper.
And good morrow, Stuart Hall with you with some fine coruscating. Oh, dear, dear, oh, dear, now. Springer, can't believe that one either. Was it some fine I can't get to the end of my sentence because of these amazing goals. Oh! At least try, for goodness sake. Now, oh! Look at that, the most hesitant goalkeeper this side of the Oh, dear, now it's a fine footballing duel there, but the goalkeeper's in the way. Oh, now if this had been the Royal Ballet, this would have been fantastic. Go on. Oh, fantastic. One almost admires the audacity. Oh, no. Oh, go on. Goodness gracious me. He tried to reach for it. He's ended up helping it in. The great useless. Oh, one almost admires the cheek of that one. Bury your head in the grass in shame. Oh, this is a wonderful save. Oh, no, it's not actually. Oh, for goodness sake, you are a ninny. Let's take a look at this. It's a fine advance forward, but the goalkeeper's ready. Oh, dear. Well, at least he slowed it down a bit. Come on, we'll give him that. Let's take a look at this. If it had been kung fu, that kick would have been wonderful. Not much help here, though. Now that the goalkeeper ready once again. Oh, but he's missed it. Mind your head on the goalpost. Oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear. And it looks as though the goalkeeper is so embarrassed, he's decided to have a snooze. Probably a good idea. That was a very strong kick. Goodness gracious, there's no stopping this one. It bounces once. The keeper's missed it. Oh, that's quite exceptional. Look at that. The goalkeeper cannot believe it. He's got his first goal there. Let's take a look at it again. And over the players, over the centre line, over the referee, over the rest of the players. They don't know where he's going to land. The keeper's got to get it. But as you can see, he's completely useless. It's in. Oh, quite marvellous. Give it some of that.
I know now why all cowboys are bow-legged. The old pommel horse. A piece of apparatus on which I myself excelled. I do a bit for you now, but I don't want to upset the people. There's no secret to success on this old fella. Stay away from the talking end, and you'll be fine. Indeed, if it's real athleticism and agility you're after, or power and poise, you need generally look no further than the gymnastics arena. Just don't look now, that's all.
Up to handstand.
And a problem with the dismount.
Powerfully up. Oh, and she ran out of podium. What a shame after such a gritty performance.
Well, I hesitate to say it, but this is a strong piece of apparatus for it. Look at this. Multiple circles on one handle, beautiful body shape. Piling on the difficulty. Oh, he's off. Front somersault. Oh, that time she lost the battle. Well, we've said earlier, this is a tall lad and they can look very good. Oh, and he's off. Oh, and he's down.
Oksana Shishovitina, having equaled the best score on the bars. What's she going to do on the vault? And she's off the bars.
Oh, and he overcooked a double twist, Sukuhara.
Yeah, I get you every time. The old double twist, Sukihara. Now, at this point, I should reassure you that, to the best of our knowledge, no one featured in the programme tonight was significantly hurt. Although I must admit, I was more than a little upset.
The director said that this jacket doesn't go with these trousers. On the ball,
as I know you are, you'll have guessed.
Indeed, if it's real athleticism and agility you're after, or power and poise, you need
generally look no further than the gymnastics arena. Just don't look now, that's all.
Up to handstand.
Had a problem with the dismount.
Powerfully up. Oh, and she ran out of podium. What a shame after such a gritty performance.
Well, I hesitate to say it, but this is a strong piece of apparatus for it. Look at this. Multiple circles on one handle. Beautiful body shape. Piling on the difficulty. Oh, and he's off. Front somersault. Oh, that time she lost the battle. Well, we've said earlier, this is a tall lad and they can look very good. Oh, and he's off. Oh, and he's down.
Oksana Shishovitina, having equaled the best score on the bars. What's she going to do on the vault? And she's off the bars.
Oh, and he overcooked the double twist, Sukihara.
Yeah, it gets you every time, the old double twist, Sukihara. Now, at this point, I should reassure you that, to the best of our knowledge, no one featured in the programme tonight was significantly hurt. Although I must admit, I was more than a little upset. The director said that this jacket doesn't go with these trousers. On the ball, as I know you are, you'll have guessed what gave it away. That we're about to hit the slopes, an area of which I can speak with some authority. How much anyone can tell me about going downhill. Not even the living legend that is Hermann Meyer, the Herminator.
He's answered all the questions asked of him so far this season. But I feared that that might happen. He only knows one way to ski. He skis absolutely flat out. And I'm afraid he's gone too quickly into that. He just didn't know how to control it. He's never terribly good on the jumps anyway. And it looks as though that very effective catch netting and the nice soft snow beyond it has done its job. He's back up on his feet.
Annie Perot it is, as Isabel Charest goes through on the inside, and Charest's gone, and so has the Chinese. This is incredible.
Now we're back to one of the big-name racers from Switzerland, the 25-year-old Bruno Kernan, who won... Oh, he's gone. He won a silver in the World Championships. In fact, the skis come off as he hooks it round the gate.
And the skis flowing nicely from turn to turn. Oh, he's lost it. No. Oh, he's got it back. Oh, he's lost it again. He's come for a heading with a spread. Oh, goodness me. He managed to just gain control in time for this heading with a spread, which was a fabulous jump. The landing, he over-rotated and out of the front door on landing, and he's going to finish on one ski.
Oh, dear. The end of him, I'm afraid. It's also the end of that gate. I hope they've got another one handy. It's going to take them a while to recover that.
The defending champions, Italy, their challenge has gone, and there's a fall. Oh, my goodness. Absolute carnage on the ice.
And he's settled into it again. Oh, he's lost. Oh, no, he's gone. Oh, dear.
Oh, and he's off the ski. He's still going, he's allowed to do it. Can he keep on the course? He could get a finish here. This could be a dramatic finish. The Austrians roaring him on. This will count. It's very slow, of course, but that counts.
Now, providing pity commentary to describe much of that action, It was the BBC's man at all the major skiing events, from Colorado to Kitzbühel, from Schliedming to St. Moritz. Yeah, you're right. It's a tough old life. But this is the man who explains exactly how and why these daring, highly accomplished experts end up making complete twits of themselves. So please welcome Julian Tutt. Julio. At last, face to go with the voice, Julian. Now, that's the almighty crash involving Hermann Meyer there.
The Herminator.
I mean, the Herminator. He puts his body and soul into it, doesn't he?
You know, he is fantastic for skiing. He has, in the last 2 years, he's completely changed the approach to skiing. Because whereas most people would sort of go 90% most of the time, he goes 100%, 100% of the time. And that's why that crash happened.
He puts his body on the line?
He puts his body on the line, yeah.
I don't know why people do it. I'll talk to you a bit later about that. But the Winter Olympics, we've heard you on the Winter Olympics. I mean, they're glamorous, are they? Nagano is the last one.
Funny place, Nagano.
Funny place, Japan.
It's on the same latitude as Los Angeles.
Yeah.
So, but because it's in the lee of a big mountain range and the geography of the place, they get a lot of precipitation, but very warm. So you get huge amounts of snow, but some other strange things happen as well. And you might think it was glamorous, but when we got there, we wondered why they had created these massive commentary boxes. Normally, you're up a bit of scaffolding, you know, at an outside broadcast, you've got a little hat on top of scaffolding and wobbles in the wind. These things were all on big RSJs in concrete blocks. And during the men's slalom, I think it was, I was quietly rabbiting away, as one does, and the racer on the course comes out at the time as the commentary box starts to wobble. And normally, if this happens when you're in a commentary box, you think, oh, somebody's just coming up the ladder, and don't worry about it. And it was only after about 5 seconds I realised that actually these commentary boxes don't wobble when somebody comes up the ladder because they're set in concrete. And not being as bright as I might be, I kept on going. The rest of them had left the commentary box, but there's a whole row of commentary boxes there. The rest of them had all gone. This was an earthquake. It was about 6 on the Richter scale.
Well, what about your BBC producer? Did he not?
He'd gone.
It's corporate mentality.
I just kept going. It was only after I thought, blimey, that was an earthquake.
That's terrifying. I suppose the biggest problem for commentators, because skiing is largely a Mitteleuropean sport, would be the names, would it?
Well, I don't know why you say that.
You've had your struggles, haven't you?
Once or twice.
I think we have some evidence of
I
your struggles.
You might have, yes.
Yeah, well, it's something you're going to be very proud of.
Second of the Russians, Vasily Bezmenil. I try that again. Bezmelnitsyn.
A brave effort.
He wasn't a regular on the circuit.
He'd probably have the same problems with Julian.
He probably would. It's a very difficult name, yeah.
Now, we also have some more evidence of your extraordinary prophetic ability when commentating. Julian Tutt gets it right again.
And he always seems to be going well and then make a big mistake. That's that. Oh, here he goes again. Oh, my goodness me. I just had a horrible feeling that that was going to happen. He's all right.
I have to be brutally frank and say that I have attempted to ski, but I'm terrified. You show me a slope like that, and I'll pull the skis off and walk away. I mean, I think it's the most frightening thing you can do. You know, and I'm, you know, although a tremendously honed athlete.
Why did they find that funny?
Probably at my peak.
I think you've got skiing legs.
Thank you. Yeah, they're pretty muscular,
yeah, they
aren't they? Tremendously powerful.
That's what you need.
Is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, what's the basic crouch then, if you don't mind
me? Can I show you?
Please.
It's probably best if I get you to go in the position.
Oh, I thought it was just going to be a demonstration by you.
The important thing,
yes,
is to lower the wind resistance as little as possible. That's it. Perfect. Yep. As low as you can get. And then you come forward. Now you stick your hands forward like that. Closer in. Like that.
Okay. I can ski!
Now you put your head down. Head down. Bum up a bit.
Okay. I can
ski! Very good.
Julian, now, I can ski.
You've got to be able to hold that for 2 minutes at 80 miles an hour.
No, I can't ski. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Julian Tutt. Can't do it the same way. Now, Julian goes off to round up the team of huskies, which are his favourite mode of transport home. It's time to highlight the plight of the people who really suffer in the name of television sport. Not the participants, not the broadcasters, not even the viewers. No, as Julian has suggested, the people who really have a hard time are the cameramen.
Go to the right a bit. Ooh. Gosh, I flinched about you. I felt that guy hit me in the stomach.
This to save the match.
Through a very narrow gap.
And what a brilliant goal.
Well, it's never fair, is it, for the bowler?
Bailey, stretch them out wide. There. Good try.
Probably on the 14th. Hello. Oh, I say.
The eye for the BBC. Anyone got a handkerchief?
Triple, that's double time. She's gone right the way through.
That the ball from Kenny Swain's clearance has jammed on the edge of our TV gantry. Well, I can promise Sunderland we will let them have it back.
He's walked round to have a second look. He bumped into the camera.
Thanks very much.
Well done, John.
Good luck.
Thanks.
Two could have a body like mine. Not careful. Still, if the choice between a life of indolence and a torso like a Teletubby on the one hand, or years of pumping iron down the gym so that you end up with a body like a bag of nuts inside a sock on the other, you know what I'd choose. After all, quite enough of that. This weightlifting, Larks, it's just a lot of effort, isn't it? Yes, there are times when it all becomes a bit too much. Not least for the BBC commentators charged with capturing all the drama and the infinite possibilities of a sporting contest. It's a heavy responsibility, which perhaps explains why they come out with such observations as this. It's now 1-1, an exact reversal of the score on Saturday. Well, this pearl of wisdom from Radio 5's estimable Alan Green. It was that game which put the Everton ship back on the road. And indeed, this classic from the immortal and much-missed Brian Johnson. There's Harvey at short leg, legs apart, waiting for a tickle. Common to all these cases, of course, is that we know what the luckless man behind the microphone was trying to say. That's here, where Paul Dickinson is saluting the heroic bronze medal winning efforts of Britain's four-man bobsleigh team at the last Winter Olympics.
That bronze medal is worth its weight in gold.
So you see what I mean? Now, people ready to pounce on your every word, who'd be a commentator?
And Stevenson folding up on the middle rope and comes out over it, and his foot appears in my face.
The Gloucestershire backs are going backwards. The chances are then that Surrey are going forwards, but no, the Gloucestershire backs are going forwards now. And both sides going backwards and forwards.
Still, Barrett's town boy, as they jump the one in front of the stands for sevens. Golden autumn, except that there aren't any stands, of course.
Two British wins, one for Ireland and now one for Germany. And Otto Schaefer, the first time that you've jumped here.
Oh, sorry, my name is Stephen. Otto is the name of...
Little time to settle down, perhaps.
Yeah, I think this is the thing with the French. You give them an inch and they take it. It's as simple as that. The light's gone out. They take it into controls, which is what they did.
Indeed, it's still raining. It was raining all night here, and it's been raining all day. It's still dripping down. And indeed, we've had a little bit of a problem inside our hut here today, haven't we, Jim? But BBC Brains, the technical boys, have got onto it.
Well, yes. Tomorrow's World have got an idea, I understand.
How many times have you been in and out with that bucket now?
A fourth finishing and close third. That's how it looks. See what you think as we see, or do we see, the closing stages.
Did you, in the backs, really feel at the end, when they were pressing hard, that you were under severe pressure in the centre particularly, weren't you?
Yeah, I wasn't actually on the field at the end, but...
Well, you...
But Magri is surely going to have him. There he goes, he's almost out on top of it. Oh. And he's come out on top of my television monitor. And he's still outside the ropes, he's not in the ring, and Harry Gibbs counts to 10. And if it wasn't for one of my splendid BBC assistants here, he would have been on top of me, because my friend on the left here, Mr. Alcott, pushed him back, and he got a little caution from Harry Gibbs for doing it.
How good is it to be back after, what, 6 weeks?
It's very good. It's a long time since I've gone.
You're out of practice.
Otto is the name of my horse.
Someone who can give us the inside track on the commentating business. He's a man who can put words in their mouths without any trouble. Please welcome the voice of them all, Terry Alderton.
Sing him! Terry Wogan, the god. There's a lot of bloomers with sports commentators and presenters. One of my favourites was a few years ago when Frank Bruno unfortunately lost his world championship to Mike Tyson. A lot of people thought that Frank Bruno would actually do 12 rounds, but that is a lot of sandwiches. Best joke. Oi. The thing is, he was interviewed a few weeks later by the god of sport, the Mr. Deslan himself. It was fantastic. And Des turned to Frank and he went, "Well, there we are. We're joined here with Frank Bruno. Frank, how are you?"
"Yeah, you know, wicked Desmond, you know what I mean? You know, duck in the diving, boxing, you know what I'm saying? You know, eating lots of toffee crumble and things, you know what I mean? You know, wicked Desmond, you know what I mean?"
"No." "Well, there we are, Frank. So you had this big fight with Mike Tyson. So do you think that Mike beat you because he was actually invincible, Frank?"
"But you know, Mike Tyson wasn't invincible, Desmond."
"How do you know?"
"I can see him quite clearly."
"But Mike Tyson Tyson, he's a big strong man. You won't want to fight Mike Tyson in a million years, but I was watching him a few weeks ago. He had this final fight before he got put away again, ironically for fighting. I thought to myself, you wouldn't want to fight Mike Tyson, but I was listening to him being interviewed and I thought, this man sounds like Elmer Thudd from Bugs Bunny. There, and then we go, well, okay, Mike, you got this big fight coming up, Mike Tyson, how do you see the fight going?
Well, you know, I'm a good fighter, I'm a great fighter, I will fight anybody, anybody that anyone wants to fight me. This is Don King, my promoter. Don, say hi. Watch it on BBC television! Well, you know, I will fight anybody, I'm a great fighter, I'm the best fighter. Hunting, I will go.
That's what I think. But also, all these sports people, they leave their sport and they go into presenting, usually sports presenting. But what I'd love to see is Chris Eubank presenting the news.
And here are the main points of the news again. Bong, my car insurance has gone up 25%. Bong, the price of petrol and diesel is disgraceful. My juggernaut cost me a fortune to fill it up. But then again, it does not matter because I am a rich man. Bong, Glenn Miller is still missing. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you. Thank you, Terry. Terry Alderton, wonderful. And now our thoughts turn to the glories of the summer game. That's cricket to you. Admirably described by the late Willie Rushton as chess with violence. Here's the evidence that everything's gone to pieces.
Well, deceived himself there and has given a second run away. Occasionally you can be a little off target with a throw-in, but rarely 180 degrees, and I think that'd defeat the entries in many a spot the ball competition.
Oh, there's a mix-up. Oh, my goodness gracious me. You would not believe that that was possible. He got so excited. In came the throw. Perfectly good, too. He had all the time in the world. And have a look at the look on the face of the captain.
Eddie Hemming's throw was perfect. And Steve Waugh had given up. He wasn't even trying to make his ground. Tufnell taking his eye off the ball.
Oh, and that must have hurt. Haynes is not having much of a trot. He's dropped two chances.
And David Gower really middled this full toss. Tremendous clip. Oh, and it hit Desi Haynes just below the knee.
Still, there are worse places you could be hit than just below the knee.
Crowd cheer. One or two players might smile, but there's one man who won't. Oh, my word, what sort of bounce was that?
That's better. One false shot and then a good shot.
Alderton looking in prime form out there, played some glorious strokes already on both sides of the wicket. Devon Malcolm short, then again.
Now, as you go into time added on for injuries to reputations, there's just room to squeeze in a parting song. Of course, when it comes to ill-advised musical ventures, I'm not one to brag. The performer of this top 40 hit from 1979 at least had the good sense to ensure that he never put this down on videotape in his own country. Now, the shrewd performer in question is a man who's been a hero to football supporters from Sonny Scunny to St. James's Park, not to mention his more recent successes with Fulham and his stewardship of the England team. Yes, from the archives of Germany's leading chart show, Musikladen, and surrounded by one-bar electric fires masquerading as a set, I'll leave you with Head Over Heels from Hair, Kevin Keegan.